Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to this afternoon session that revolves around skin circulation as a target for lifestyle intervention and some innovation in measurement of skin blood flow. For those of you who don't know my name, I'm Tim Cable. I'm from the University of Birmingham, and I'm currently past president of the European College for the next 3 days, and then I'm nothing after that. There's an awful lot of people in the audience that I know and that know me well. Some of you will know that I'm at times a little bit absent-minded. So I have to start the presentation with an apology. So Lacey Alexander was meant to be on the program. I had a communication malfunction, and an apology to Lacey is that because of my malfunction, she can't be here today. But we have a super duper substitute at the last minute that I'll introduce in a little while, and we have a really nice program this afternoon. So I hope that you all enjoy it in this magnificent, if not somewhat large, venue. So let me just set the context a little bit before I hand over to our first speaker. So the cutaneous circulation is expansive. It's a richly innervated vascular bed located in the dermis. And since it's only around about 1 to 2 millimeters under the epidermal surface, it provides us with easy access for the assessment of cardiovascular health, and indeed is often thought of as a sentinel for the early dysfunction in the microcirculation. Despite the ease of access, however, the regulatory control mechanisms are complex and remain to be definitively elucidated even now after some 40, 50 years of research into those areas. In response to passive heating, there's an increase in skin blood flow that you can see here, which may reach 5 to 7 liters per minute. And this is this active vasodilatation is coordinated through the sympathetic cholinergic release of acetylcholine from cholinergic neurotransmitters and other co-transmitters such as VIP, calcitonin, gene-related peptide, and substance P, for example, bring about their effects downstream through activating endothelial and smooth muscle initiatives to bring about a blood flow response that's largely nitric oxide dependent. You can see that that's the passive response to heating. When you have an exercise-induced increase in skin blood flow, you get a downward and rightward shift of that curve due to other central autonomic and cardiovascular reflexes kicking in. So traditionally, skin blood flow has been measured by looking at changes in the surface, the skin temperature on the surface of the body, or through strain gauge plethysmography, which measures whole limb blood flow, or in the forearm or the leg, and indeed more locally using laser Doppler flowmetry to look at the localized changes in red cell flux in response to heating or other vasoactive substances that can be introduced into the dermis through either iontophoresis or microdialysis. And I know our presenters are going to talk more about that later. There are new technologies that are going to be covered by Professor Green, so I won't talk about those. And I'll move right on now to introduce our speakers. I'll talk about all of them just here on this slide. So our excellent substitute is going to be Dr. Louise Naylor from the University of Western Australia. She's leading a world-class research agenda on cardiovascular health and interventions, but today she's going to be looking at the impact of aging and disease on the skin microcirculation. That's followed by Professor Helen Jones from Liverpool John Moores University, and Helen's going to be looking at the impact of female reproductive hormones on the skin microcirculation. And then you all know, I think, Danny Green. He's been a regular presenter at this Congress over the years. I couldn't resist Danny putting this photograph up, I'm sorry. But, and it's for 2 points. Three points. The first one, the curly hair. The second one is that this photograph was taken almost exactly 30 years ago. And the third one, look at the type of technology in use in that photograph and compare that and contrast it with the sort of technologies that you're going to see in around about an hour and 20 minutes time. To see how the field has moved forward, all of our fields, but there's some real high class work coming out from Danny and his team at the University of Western Australia. So without further ado, could I ask you to welcome Louise Naylor to the stage to give her presentation. Thank you. I should say we will follow each presentation by questions and then we'll have a panel discussion at the end. Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry, just have to adjust the mic. Sorry, Tim. So I am not Lacey, I'm Louise. And today I'm going to be talking about the skin as a target for lifestyle interventions, particularly looking at clinical populations and the elderly. So in Nature in 2004, there was a review which showed that humans have evolved to become a magnificent endurance creatures. And perhaps not now with the inactivity that's around the place, but our predecessors at least were really those that were made to be able to outrun pretty much any creature on this planet, especially when it was a hot environment. And this is largely because of the remarkable physiological adaptations of the skin. What you're seeing here up on this slide is an adaptation from second year physiology, which you probably all know from a cardinal catch and catch. The heart pumps at around 5 litres per minute, and the blood goes all the way around. And as you'll see at the bottom part in the blue, that 5 litres per minute is distributed evenly amongst the skeletal muscle, a little bit, about 4 or 5% of it goes to the skin, some goes to the heart and also to the brain. This changes dramatically during heavy exercise where the cardiac output increases to about 25 litres per minute. And a massive proportion, almost 85%, nearly all of this blood flow goes straight to the muscles. And that is really so that we can match the metabolic demands. But when we're exposed to environmental heat, we set up this competition because the skin has to have blood flow going to it. And you can see that almost 20% of the blood flow wants to go to the skin so that we can vasodilate and to thermoregulate. So it is said that the demands of each of these circulations can exceed that of the cardiac output. So the combination of an environmental heat stress and exercise actually represents one of the greatest challenges to our cardiovascular system. The vascular endothelium, as Tim pointed out, is very critical in this ability for the circulation to go to the skin microvessels. There is some direct evidence that the microcirculation is related to cardiovascular disease risk factors, as you can see here. So healthy individuals between the ages of 30 and 70 were recruited, and then their risk for cardiovascular disease was determined using the Framingham Heart Study risk factor scores, and they are across the bottom. What you'll be able to see is that there is a stepwise decrease in the ability of the skin blood flow to increase, which is matched with an increase in the cardiovascular disease risk factors. So an impairment of this endothelial function, of the cutaneous vascular function, is actually related to a clinical risk of cardiovascular disease. And hopefully you'll be able to see throughout our presentations that this actually manifests before overt cardiovascular disease risk factors become evident. So we'll start off by looking at what actually happens when the heart is failing to the skin, and what is the limit. So our group recruited a group of heart failure patients and designed an experiment where we put them in an environmental heat chamber and gave them whole body heat. And the experimental design you can see here uses microdialysis, where LNAME, or L-name, which blocks the nitric oxide component, was used and compared to a ringer site. And then the individuals, the controls, and the heart failure participants were put into a climate chamber, and there was a prolonged heating protocol, and at the very end, SMP was administered as well so that we could get the maximum dilatory capacity, or the CVC. So this is the microdialysis technique that Tim introduced to us. A fine needle is inserted in, threaded through the skin, and then through that, a semipermeable membrane is implanted and left in the skin. And then the laser Doppler flowometers are put on top of that so that we can directly measure the skin blood flow of the capillary beds that we have then infused different medications or pharmaceuticals into, and in this case, it's L-name, which blocks nitric oxide. Remember that I'm from Australia, so we tried to do a naturally occurring hot environment, which was 90 minutes at 38 degrees Celsius and 59 degrees of relative humidity. And these are the results that you can see. So in the both groups, the heart failure as well as control, there was a significant increase in both skin and core temperatures with whole body heating. But these were similar between the two groups. Looking at the ringer site, we can see the response to the skin blood flow. So in the red section here is where they are heated for a prolonged period of time in the chamber, and before that is the baseline. What you'll be able to see here is, again, both the heart failure and the control participants had a significant increase in their skin blood flow during heating. But when you start to look at the contribution of nitric oxide to this, again, both groups, significant improvement at all the time points, and you can see pointed out here that at 60, 75, and 90 minutes of prolonged heating, there was a significant contribution, as seen by the difference in the ringers and the L-name sites in the control subjects. And in the heart failure patients, there was a response, but smaller in magnitude, and only at the very end of that prolonged heating period, which shows to us that those heart failure patients exhibited a reduced contribution of nitric oxide to the heating stimulus. So for this, the nitric oxide is very important. In healthy people, we know that an increase in skin blood flow is due to an increase in the core temperature, and that is really mediated by the nitric oxide. We saw in these heart failure patients there was a smaller contribution of nitric oxide, and therefore can conclude that in heart failure patients, there was an impaired thermoregulatory response to the heat exposure, and also that there was lower skin blood flow in the heart failure patients during the heat exposure, which may predispose these subjects to heat intolerance. But it also raises the question, we know that sweating and active vasodilation may be influenced by cardiorespiratory fitness. So, is there something that we can do to improve this? I.e., we're at an exercise and sports conference, exercise training. So to look at that, we did another study, or our group did another study, looking at the effects of aging and cardiorespiratory fitness on the ability of the skin to vasodilate and the contribution of nitric oxide to this. As you can see illustrated here, three groups were recruited. There were sedentary older individuals, and they were only over the age of 50. There was also an older group that were relatively fit, and they were compared to a final group of active young individuals. This time we were interested in both the physiological and the pharmacological vasodilation, which is two different ways of assessing the skin blood flow. So the first technique that was used was that of local heating, which induces a physiological vasodilation. This is a technique that's been modified by Kellogg and colleagues, and they've been able to show that with a slow incremental heating protocol, it is largely nitric oxide dependent. The other stimulus that was used was that of the infusion of acetylcholine. Acetylcholine, as Tim has already said to us, is another way to vasodilate the skin, which is not that much mediated by the nitric oxide. And there was a dose response curve of the acetylcholine that was looked at as well. So again, this was done through the microdialysis. And in both of these, L-name was infused into the microcirculation so that we could look at the nitric oxide contribution to the responses of the physiological and the pharmacological vasodilation. And here are the results. The older sedentary individuals had reduced nitric oxide contribution both at baseline, at peak heating, and following prolonged heating. And you can also see at the bottom panel here that the decrease in the nitric oxide contribution to the prolonged heating, which was after 30 minutes at 42 degrees Celsius, was seen in the older sedentary individuals. Interestingly, you might note that for the older fit individuals, there was no decline. Looking at the infusion of acetylcholine to this, again, similar results where there was a reduction in the older sedentary individuals, which was not seen in the healthy individuals. Which leads us to conclude that the contribution of nitric oxide to vasodilation is impaired in older sedentary subjects. And also that if you are elderly, fitness preserves this decline. But that led us to the question of, can exercise be used as a therapy to improve the skin blood flow of those individuals who had a decline? So of the individuals that were elderly and sedentary, 16 of them agreed to remain in the study and participated in another further 24 weeks. Of that, there was 24 weeks of exercise training, and then they were randomized to either have the heating or the pharmaceutical manipulations at the end. So here are the results of the exercise training program, and you can see that there was a significant improvement in the VO2, i.e. the exercise training did what it was meant to do. But you'll also notice that there was no changes in the systolic blood pressure, body mass index, or any of the body composition measures. And I'll ask you to remember that because we'll come back to that later. But what happened to the skin? So what we're looking at here are, it's quite a small graph actually, so I apologize for that. The training at 12 and 24 weeks, and also at entry of the previously sedentary elderly individuals. So the training significantly increased the cutaneous vascular conductance in response to heating after 12 weeks and also after 24 weeks of exercise training. Therefore, exercise training was able to restore the skin blood flow of the back to the levels of the fit but otherwise healthy individuals who are also older. Same was true for the pharmacological interventions, where we again saw that the training was able to, both at 12 and 24 weeks, restore the blood flow to that of the elderly but fit individuals. So our take-home message from this is that there is an age-related decline in the microvascular nitric oxide-mediated vasodilatory function, that a decrease in the nitric oxide-mediated vasodilatory function in the older, sedentary, but otherwise healthy volunteers was compared to both younger subjects and age-matched individuals who maintain their level of fitness. Therefore, your fitness matters. And even more importantly, exercise training the older sedentary subjects reversed the impairment of nitric oxide microvascular function. Therefore, exercise training matters. So with this in hand, we had another question. Can we save other people? Thanks, Tim. So childhood obesity has become epidemic around the world, and it's really leading now to what we used to be calling adult onset diabetes in adolescents and even young adults. So this is data from Australia. The prevalence of type 2 diabetes over the last 10 years has increased tenfold. We are now seeing the youngest participants that we've had through our studies have been six-year-old children with type 2 diabetes. The International Diabetes Federation says that type 2 diabetes in young people is a disease with unique implications, which results in very poor outcomes over 10 to 20 years. So by the time that they're middle-aged or in their 30s even, they have very severe cardiovascular disease. And to make things even worse, puberty is a time which causes an acceleration of the microvascular complications, and this might be related to their insulin resistance. I know you won't be able to read this, so let me point out that this study shows us that young people with type 2 diabetes have significantly higher rates compared to their counterparts who've had type 1 diabetes of all sorts of cardiovascular complications, despite having diabetes for a shorter period of time and having a better control of their glycemia than their type 1 counterparts. So this is really a group that we felt we wanted to help. The good news is that the disease may be reversible if it's caught early and treated well in the early stages. But the problem is that there is limited evidence as to the best treatment modalities for type 2 diabetes. And so we found this information from the International Diabetes Foundation, which really says, Federation, which says that the treatment goals for the children and adolescents are to achieve the physiological and psychological well-being, long-term blood glucose control, and also to prevent the microvascular complications and the macrovascular disease. We had also previously shown that in this cohort, there was an impairment of the endothelial function of the chondrite or the large vessels, as you can see here. So this is the data showing both the IMT of the carotid artery and on your right, the flow-mediated dilation, which is the conduit artery vessel function, significantly decreased in the type 2 diabetics, even compared to their obese counterparts, and particularly so against the lean but otherwise healthy age-matched controls. So we designed a study where we wanted to see whether exercise training would be beneficial. So the aim of the study was to determine the effects of a 12-week exercise program on insulin sensitivity and body composition in adolescents with type 2 diabetes. But of course, we were also interested in those microvascular complications. And we also wanted to see whether you can exercise train them in a formal setting and those benefits would then be able to persist. But before we could look at the microvascular circulation, we need to take a step backwards, and we did a validation study. And really what we were looking at there was, if you change the insulin sensitivity of these individuals, are you also changing the microvascular function? Or is it the exercise training that's changing the microvascular function itself? So we designed a study to look at the effects of an acute bout of hyperglycemia, changing their blood sugar levels, on the microvascular function in diabetics. And we did this by using a glycemic clamp. So a glycemic clamp is basically where you infuse insulin and also glucose, and you manipulate that individual's ability to change their levels. So one group was stayed at 5 millimoles at euglycemia, and the other group was elevated to hyperglycemia. While we did this, we also used the slow heating protocol and looked at the microvascular function and used LNAMe to look at the nitric oxide contribution. So our results showed that there was a significant increase in the skin blood flow associated with heating in both groups, as is expected. And there was a significant contribution of nitric oxide to this response. But there were no differences between the controls and the diabetics at either of the temperatures. Looking at the type 1 diabetics that were at euglycemia and hyperglycemia, so by manipulating their blood sugar levels, there was also no response in their microvascular function. So we were able to say that this was a valid technique, and acute changes in glycemic control did not affect the microvascular function. Therefore, any results that we saw with exercise training would be due to the exercise training and all of its amazing benefits, rather than just simply by changing their glycemic control. So coming back to our study in type 2 diabetics, we assessed their large blood vessel function, again using the flow-mediated dilation technique, and we also used laser Doppler and microdialysis, as well as the local heating protocol that I've already explained for you. This time we looked at their insulin sensitivity, again using a clamp, but this is a slightly different clamp where we are now looking at the whole body insulin sensitivity, or the M score, which is actually a surrogate measure for the net glucose utilization or the sensitivity to insulin of that individual. And a higher M shows better sensitivity. So some of the type 2 diabetics were randomized to receive exercise training. Others maintained their usual activity levels. And then we followed them up again after the formal period had finished to see whether we were able to see a persistent change. You may remember that I asked you before to remember that with the exercise training protocol before, there was no changes to body mass, body composition, or anything except for the microvasculature. And again, we saw that with our exercise training program, there was no change in body weight. There was also no change in fitness. No changes in our insulin sensitivity. So even though we did our validation project before, it wasn't required because the exercise training actually didn't change the insulin sensitivity of these type 2 diabetics. But what we did see was the exercise training actually halted the natural decline that we saw in 12 weeks with the type 2 diabetics who did not get the exercise intervention. Macrovascular function results are here, and you can see that there was a significant improvement in the large blood vessel endothelial function with exercise training in the type 2 diabetics, which was not seen in the control group. And finally, there was also a significant improvement in the microvascular function. So in conclusion, there was an improvement in the endothelial function, both the small and the large blood vessels. Exercise training was able to attenuate the increase in fat mass and mitigate the increases in insulin sensitivity, but these changes in the vasculature actually occurred independent of any changes of body mass, BMI, insulin sensitivity, or anything else. So I remind you again of the clinical relevance of the blood vessels, and that really is that the cutaneous vascular function precedes overt cardiovascular disease risk factors. So the implications of these studies together are that microvascular function is related to cardiovascular disease, and microvascular function, we've shown, was reduced in heart failure patients and in the elderly unfit individuals. The good news here is that exercise training can improve these microvessels and that nitric oxide contributes to this. But these changes are independent to, or they occur earlier to, changes in cardiovascular disease risk factors that we traditionally look for in our research studies and also clinically. So this really highlights the importance of promoting a healthy lifestyle and regular exercise to all individuals before they develop overt cardiovascular disease. Thank you.
Many thanks, Louise. Paper open for some questions. If you could state your name and affiliation, thank you.
Thank you very much for a wonderful presentation. My name is Barakat Falk. I'm from Brock University and in Canada. So I actually have two questions, if that's okay.
That's fine.
One has to do with the heart failure patients, where you showed that they had lower skin blood flow, or lower increase in skin blood flow, and you said that their thermoregulation was impaired. But it could be, did you measure sweating rate or temperature?
We did temperature, yeah.
Core temperature?
Yep.
Okay, so that was higher? Okay, so the sweating rate must have been lower. Okay. And then my second, I guess it's a comment, I don't know if it's a question, but this has to do with the adolescents that were training, mm-hmm. and you pointed out that they didn't lose any weight, which is similar to the older population that was training. But for children and adolescents, if they maintain body weight, that's actually a positive effect, because had they just continued to grow, then they would have increased body weight. So it's not the same, I don't think. So maybe it does have to do a little bit with the change in body weight, but also body composition.
Yeah. So we looked at body composition as well and saw that there was a favorable improvement there where the muscle was increased and the fat was decreased. So just to put into context, this patient group, their average weight was about 90 kilos as an adolescent. So they were quite remarkably overweight. Yeah. But of course, we're not targeting body weight anyway as our primary outcome. So.
Another question.
Come on, Tim, that was two questions. You said two questions.
Well, we did such a good job with the presentation. You can handle some more questions.
Really, really interesting. Really interesting presentation. I might have missed it. What was the volume and intensity of the training that the adolescents underwent?
The volume. So it was personalised for each individual based on their VO2, which was done beforehand, and also a one rep max test. So it was a circuit weight training protocol where we were using both a heart rate, which I would actually have to look up the details, but I think it started around 65% of their maximum and progressed to about 80, 85% for the aerobic component. And also we used the strength component, the 1RM, to do the intensity for that. It was a center-based program where they trained three times a week, and each session sort of varied slightly.
Sorry, I just wondered whether there was any overload built into the training.
Yep. So every 3 weeks, the 1RM test was repeated, and it was progressed according to that. They actually worked really hard, and some of the individuals, their lean body mass increased remarkably. It was just, we didn't see an improvement in VO2, and we didn't see an improvement in body weight, per se. Sorry, I've got a light there.
All right. Many thanks, Louise, and many thanks again for stepping in at the last minute and saving my bacon. Could you thank Louise for an excellent presentation? So I'd now like to welcome Professor Helen Jones from Liverpool John Moores to the podium to tell us about the effect of female reproductive hormones on this circulation. Welcome, Helen.
So I'm going to have to rearrange these. Thanks, Louise. Okay, so I want to talk to you specifically today about females. I'm going to follow on from some of the techniques and some of the information that Louise has already provided today. So first of all, I'm just going to recap. So in terms of the local mediation of increasing skin blood flow, so we can test the microvascular function in a specific way, but we can test it in a specific way where we just look at one very small part of the skin and we can heat that up using a laser Doppler probe, as Tim showed earlier on in the session. So there's two aspects of heating up the skin. Firstly, if we start heating up, we get an initial vasodilatory response. Does this work? Okay. And this is actually mediated by the sensory nerves, and they release a neurotransmitter which causes vasodilation. If the heating is prolonged and incremental, then the endothelium takes over somewhat. So for prolonged vasodilation, the endothelium takes over and you'll get a response which is mediated mostly by a nitric oxide. So when we heat the skin in this way, we get a really predictable response. And this predictable response has three patterns. First of all, as we start the heating, we get this axon reflex, which is mediated by the sensory nerves. And you'll get an initial peak and then a trough, as you can see on the screen here. When we heat a little bit further for a longer time period, normally over 30 minutes in this type of test, The second part, we get a secondary peak with a plateau, and this is mediated more by the endothelial cells, and it's thought that it's mediated at least 70% by nitric oxide. We can then carry on heating for a while to a higher temp, so from 42 to 44 degrees. And we can maximally vasodilate the microvessels. And this maximal vasodilation is thought to be or can be used as a marker of vascular structure. And Danny will come on to measurements of vascular structure in the next talk. So, as Louise has presented very nicely in the talk previously, we know that if we assess the microvascular response to heat and to local heating in this way, as she presented in, for example, the data by Mark Black with aging, that with exercise training, this predictable response can actually be enhanced. And in cardiovascular disease, in some cardiovascular diseases, that this predictable response can actually be impaired. So I want to start by pointing out that this is the current information that we have on skin blood flow, where we use local heating. And most of the studies that have contributed to this information have really concentrated on recruiting male participants. There are a number of studies that have recruited male and female participants, but they've not differentiated between the two in these studies. So why is this important? So besides the obvious differences between males and females, which include body composition, including fat mass and muscle mass, and reproductive hormones, there's also anatomical differences, specifically in the skin. And as you can see by these two images here, so we've got on the top an image of the forearm of a female's forearm, and there's not a lot of skin, and then, there's not a lot of hair. And on the bottom, we have an image here of I think this is Rob Shave's arm, which is clearly got much more hair. So anatomically, there's differences, and there's anatomically, but what we also don't know if these vessels anatomically in the skin, in the dermis layer between males and females, are actually larger or not, because we find it very difficult to assess the structure and the size and image the size of these vessels. So it's possible that the size of the vessels are also different between males and females. And we know this that because in conduit arteries or other arteries of the body that we can image, males generally have larger vessels than females. What I'm going to present to you today is some limited information, because there's limited research, that there's differences in the function of the microcirculation and microvascular endothelial function between males and females. So it's important to note here that males and females are simply just not the same. There are key physiological differences. And here's a study actually by Lacey Alexander's group. So I thought, given that Lacey wasn't here today, I'd put up some of their data. And they actually looked in this study at differences between males and females in the microvascular response to local heating. And in this study, they used the microdialysis technique that Louise described in the previous presentation. And they put microdialysis fibers in the arms and in the legs. They had two in the arms, two in the legs, infused one with a ringers or a control site, and the other with a nitric oxide blocker. And what they found in this study was that the contribution of nitric oxide to the increase in skin blood flow to local heating was actually different in males and females, specifically in the forearm. So this data is suggesting that there is evidence of sex differences in cutaneous microvascular response to local heating. Okay, so if there's clearly differences between men and women, let's see or try and find out some reasons why. So over the lifespan of a female, reproductive hormones vary. So in premenopausal women, reproductive hormones vary cyclical over a 28-day period. reproductive hormones increase dramatically during pregnancy and also decrease dramatically following the menopause. So there's one study to date, which is a fairly old study, and in this study they used a technique called anatophoresis, which is specifically looking at the endothelial function of the skin microvasculature, not specifically the nitric oxide proportion. And in this study, they measured skin vascular function in three phases of the menstrual cycle. They've got the early follicular phase, late follicular phase, and the luteal phase. And the reproductive hormones vary greatly in these phases, but there was no differences in the skin microvascular response here in this data. A further study was performed using the same technique. This time they were looking at differences between pre- and postmenopausal women. And you can see here on the slide that following the menopause, the skin microvascular response is actually reduced. And in this data, they also had a group of postmenopausal women who received hormone replacement therapy. And you can see there from the figure that the microvascular response was attenuated, or the decrease in the microvascular response was attenuated somewhat following hormone replacement therapy. So we've got some evidence here suggesting that age has an impact on the microvascular response to heating. So let's look a little bit closer into hormones. So here's two studies, and in these two studies, they used this they use laser Doppler to get this predictable response in local heating. In the first study over here, this is by Chris Minton's group, they systematically down-regulated healthy females' reproductive hormones for a set period, then introduced systematically estrogen on its own, as you can see here and here, and then progesterone on its own, and then the combination of the two. And obviously perform this local heating response following a set period under this hormone response. There was evidence in this study that the axon reflex was actually influenced by estrogen and progesterone, and that those responses were similar. But there was no evidence that estrogen and progesterone had an impact on the plateau phase, so the secondary phase, the endothelial phase of this response. On this side of the screen is some earlier data. So this data is from 20 or so years ago now. Again, looking at the impact of reproductive hormones, this time using the oral contraceptive pill, where there's a phase of low hormones where they don't take the oral contraceptive pill for a 7-day period, and they measured the skin blood flow response. And then after taking the oral contraceptive pill for 3 weeks, or 21 days, to get a higher level of estrogen and progesterone. So in response to the local heating, you can see here at the higher temperatures, there were some differences in terms of skin blood flow between these two hormone phases, and skin blood flow was higher at the higher temperatures in the high hormone phase. So this is some evidence to suggest that female sex hormones have some impact on the microvascular response to heating. So on the previous slide, I showed you that microvascular response to heating was actually attenuated in postmenopausal women. So these are healthy postmenopausal women, and they've got a reduced endothelial function in the skin. So given that, we need to try and obviously develop some interventions to try and improve that. And one way to do that, like Louise has shown previously, can exercise training have an impact? And there are a number of studies that have actually looked at the impact of exercise training on skin microvascular function. But again, a lot of this work has been performed in male participants or males and females together without specifically looking at females alone and the response of females to exercise training. Here's one study, I think they're one of very few studies that have actually looked at females, and this was in postmenopausal women. Actually, this was one of Tim Cable's PhD student studies. And they used the anatophoresis technique to assess endothelial function in the skin. And you can see from the slide here that the woman did a 48-week training intervention, aerobic training. And the black bars here are just resting skin blood flow. And the white bars here are the response to acetylcholine. So you can see over the 48 weeks of training, skin blood flow, baseline skin blood flow didn't change, but the response to acetylcholine actually increased, suggesting that the exercise training in healthy postmenopausal women had an impact on improving endothelial function in the cutaneous vasculature. So whilst there's evidence to suggest that exercise training can have a beneficial effect on healthy females, this study was performed in the absence of estrogen, where potentially postmenopausal women actually had a reduced cutaneous vascular responsiveness. There's no studies to date that I can find that actually look at the exercise training response of microvascular function in healthy premenopausal women, and that's something that we probably need to do over the next few years to understand the changes post-menopause. So it's not only important to just understand the microvascular response for healthy women, so we can understand how that changes with post-menopause or different times of life and health and disease. It's also important to understand endothelial function in women in general, so we can understand other conditions and other periods, times of life that this is important for. So to try and put this into a little bit of context, here's some data on women who have polycystic ovaries or polycystic ovary syndrome. And this actually affects 20% of premenopausal women. And these women not only have polycystic ovaries, they also show a higher prevalence of components of the metabolic syndrome. And these contribute to a higher cardiovascular disease risk in these women. These components are higher or greater in those women who've got PCOS and have got biochemical hyperandrogenism. In other words, they've got high testosterone levels. We performed a study a few years ago now, and we looked, using the microdialysis technique, we looked to see if these women actually had reduced microvascular function. And we looked at specifically the nitric oxide contribution, and as you can see here from the figure, the gray bar is the controls, and across all aspects of heating, the gray bar is higher than the black bar, and this is showing that the nitric oxide contribution is impaired in women that have PCOS. But when we exercised that trained them, we were able to improve their nitric oxide contribution to skin blood flow, so we were able to enhance their cutaneous endothelial function. So some evidence is, again, to suggest that exercise training is beneficial in females, but again, I point out that this is in the presence of high testosterone and that these women had impaired or attenuated microvascular function at baseline. So moving sideways a little bit to look at cutaneous microvascular function in a different way. As Louise suggested on her first slide, we can also have an increase in skin blood flow when we have an increase in heat stress, either internally or externally, and this is mediated by an increase in core body temperature. So as we get an increase in core body temperature, I'm just going to point out here, here's our heat stress. At a certain point or a certain core body temperature, we get a cutaneous vasodilation to dissipate heat. And after this cutaneous vasodilation, we then get an exponential rise in skin blood flow. And the slope of this rise, or the steepness of this slope, is also important. So the temperature threshold and the slope of, or how much skin blood flow after the temperature threshold, is important because it gives us information about cutaneous microvascular function, but it also gives us information about thermoregulatory efficiency. So, for example, if the slope if the core temperature threshold decreases. This means that we will be vasodilating at an earlier core temperature, which means that we would be dissipating heat quicker and at an earlier core temperature, which would prevent us getting hotter. At the same time, if our rise in skin blood flow after this threshold, if this slope was steeper and we got more skin blood flow, we would be able to dissipate heat at a faster rate. So the thresholds and slopes are important markers that we can use in research studies to give us information about cutaneous microvascular function. In this study here, this was on a group of young, healthy females. And you can see here that the temperature threshold is actually lower in a group of trained, healthy females compared to an untrained group. And actually, the slope of the response is also steeper in the endurance-trained individuals compared to the untrained group. In the trained group, this heating test was performed in the early follicular phase and the luteal phase, and there was no difference in the threshold or the slopes. But in the untrained women, across the menstrual cycle, these responses, or at least the threshold response, was actually different. So, looking at a group of premenopausal and postmenopausal women in this study that we performed in Liverpool, we were looking at thresholds and slopes and if they actually differed across the menopause. And you can see here the data, the threshold doesn't change. So there's no difference between pre and early postmenopausal women in the temperature threshold. But there's some evidence to suggest that in postmenopausal women that the slope is decreased, you're getting less skin blood flow after your cutaneous vasodilation. This may suggest that postmenopausal women may not dissipate heat as efficiently as premenopausal women. Again, if postmenopausal women or healthy premenopausal women have some type of microvascular dysfunction, then exercise training or interventions to help this are important. Here's data from three different studies showing that exercise training can change the threshold, the core temperature threshold for vasodilation, in that it's lower after exercise training. This data over here is in premenopausal women, and the open white symbols are the training data. The black symbols are actually the pre-data and the detraining data, and you can see that the threshold improves with training and it actually goes back to where it was after a period of detraining. There was no change in the slope in this study or any of the studies here on this slide. Again, we've got some data from Liverpool. This is an exercise training study in premenopausal women, and temperature threshold was lower. And in the same study with a heating intervention of water heating, we again get the same response. In postmenopausal women here, we got the same response and there was no change in the control. So exercise training decreases the temperature threshold for vasodilation in young and early postmenopausal women, suggesting that exercise training has a positive impact on improving skin microvascular function and also possibly thermoregulatory efficiency. Again, to put this in a little bit of context, why it's important to try and understand this. Following the menopause, obviously you've got a decrease in estrogen, and as I've hopefully shown, estrogen, that skin blood flow is impacted by estrogen. And the main symptom of the menopause is hot flushes. And hot flushes is a sudden and intense sensation of heat that causes skin flushing, i.e. increases in skin blood flow, and also sweating. And we performed a study a few years ago now that where we actually measured skin blood flow during a hot flush. That was actually before, during, and following a hot flush. And then we exercise trained these women to have a look at if we were able to have an impact on the severity of the hot flushes. So we've got data here with exercise training, and you can see with the red lines that there was actually lower skin blood flow during a hot flush following the exercise training, and there was no difference over here in the control data. So if we get a reduction in skin blood flow during a hot flush, that actually equates to a reduction in the severity of a hot flush, which is clearly important to women that are experiencing these symptoms. So in summary, clearly men and women are not the same. They're different, and they're different in terms of their skin microvessel function. I probably wanted to start this presentation with there are no studies, or there are very little studies. So my biggest conclusion is that we need more studies in females, and we need more studies that are mechanistic, that are exercise training in healthy people and diseased people. But also, we also need some more novel and better ways to assess the skin microvessel function. Obviously, microdialysis, infusing the drugs through the microdialysis fibers is an excellent improvement over the past 10 years, but we're still using laser Doppler just to look at flux underneath the skin. We need more novel techniques, and I'm trying to give Danny a big plug here for his next talk. Okay. So first of all, I'd like to thank obviously some of my colleagues and collaborators that have contributed to some of these studies that are presented today. Also like to thank my co-speakers, and last but not least, obviously I'd like to thank the chair for his impeccable organisation skills, which he usually does in a very relaxed manner.
Thank you, Helen. Yeah, we got time for a quick question. Should somebody want to ask one? Oh, go on, Jose.
Thank you very much, Helen, for the presentation. You show that there's mechanistically there's difference between men and women. Like, something that I know is whether there's any study where they're comparing women versus men to a given heat stress level, and demonstrated where you control for surface area, and so whether there's differences in the increases in skin blood flow between men and women.
I don't think there is a study, Jose. I think that's one for you to be able to do in Brunel. I think the male and female differences are really more apparent in the local heating response rather than the reflex response. I think the reflex response also needs more work in looking at sex differences, but also pre- and post-menopausal differences too.
Okay, yeah, please.
A very quick question, I think, because you've shown very nicely that estrogen probably has an effect on skin blood flow, and you've shown this in younger women and then in older women with and without oral contraceptive and menopause, etc. But just I'm wondering, if you think of girls versus women, also the estrogen levels are different, so do you have any data, or do you know of any data that compare girls and women?
Girls, as in you mean
pre-puberty?
Yeah. So, no.
See, that was short.
Yeah, I'm not aware of many skin blood flow studies at all in adolescent males or females, besides obviously Louise's.
So thanks, Helen. You've left us with some important questions to answer. Can you thank Helen again? Thank you. And now the turn of Winthrop Professor Danny Green from the University of Western Australia. It's fair to say Danny's a thought leader in cardiovascular physiology. I think he's here today to challenge some paradoxes and show us some innovation in measurement techniques. Over to you, when loaded, Danny.
Yeah. Great. Thank you. Thanks very much, Tim. It's rare that I have the opportunity to be introduced by a chairman who's shorter than I am, so it's a great pleasure to be here. And thanks to previous speakers who've set the scene beautifully for the talk I'm going to give today. This talk is entitled New Insights into Structure and Function in the Skin. And I'd like to set the scene with a couple of sort of big picture conceptual slides about why my group are interested in skin microvascular physiology. So there's a couple of shocking slides coming up, and here's the first of them. This is, I've known Tim Campbell a very long time, suffice to say. Global changes in disease risk between 2005 and 2015, published in The Lancet in 2016. So this is a decade of data in the causes of death. This is the list of causes of death in rank order. So the biggest cause of death internationally is ischemic heart disease, followed by cerebrovascular disease. And I've circled or highlighted a number of diseases here which are all atherosclerotic in nature. So about 5 of the top 10 or 15 killers worldwide are all vascular diseases, and many of them are microvascular in nature, including dementia. The changes over that decade, so the top two kill about 17 million people a year, and the top cause of death by cancer causes about $1.7 million a year. You put that up for the cancer researchers in the audience. This is the change with increased badness to your right and decreased goodness to your left. So this is the change caused by age and cause-specific mortality rate. So that's the incidence, age-related incidence. And superimposed on that is the change related to population aging and changes due to population growth. So the demographic shifts are more than overpowering the beneficial effects that we think we're having on age-dependent incidence. The burden of the cardiovascular diseases is increasing in the world, not decreasing. And I put that up because it's commonly thought that we've had a bit of a win in cardiovascular diseases worldwide, but actually the burden's increasing. And a lot of the global burden of death and morbidity is vascular. So that's the first context-raising slide. The second context-raising slide is sort of the dark secret of cardiology. And to explain that, I've got to put up this image of an artery, and sort of if you had an x-axis on this, it might be age or it might be disease status. But what you can see is an artery that might look clear early in life and an artery that looks like it's got a raised occlusive lesion late in life. There's a sort of superimposed plaque frequency, and that's just to demonstrate to you that in any individual at a given age, there are a few number of complex raised lesions, and there are lots of non-complex, soft, and eccentric lesions. And that the early stages of the pathogenesis of atherosclerosis are all eccentric in nature. They don't occlude the lumen, and they don't cause ischemia, and they don't cause angina, and they don't cause symptoms. And yet, the prevailing paradigm for detection of this disease occurs here. We detect the disease because either people have an infarct or a stroke, or they have some symptom of angina, like angina, which is ischemic in nature. We detect this disease extremely late, and it's a global burden which is compelling. About half the people who actually find out that they've got atherosclerotic disease find out because they've had an infarct or a stroke. Silent stroke is 5 times more prevalent than symptomatic stroke, so it's not just the heart, it's the circulation at large. But the big thing that shocked me when I looked into this sort of stuff years ago is that, almost counterintuitively, most cardiovascular events happen in arteries that are not stenotic. About 70% of cardiovascular events happen in arteries that don't look that narrow. Only 14% of events happen in arteries that have a larger than 70% stenosis. 70% stenosis is relevant because they're the ones that cardiologists try to open. If you have a stenosis that's less than 70%, usually you manage conservatively until it grows a bit more and then you get your angioplasty and your stent. Notwithstanding all of that, most infarcts are happening at a much earlier stage in arteries that are not detectable by angiography and not fixable with a stent. So, we detect this disease extremely late, and it's a global and compelling burden. And that's the context for what I'm going to talk about next. I'm going to get through some large artery data, and then because that's relevant to what we've learnt about small vessels that we're studying now. So the goal here is not to detect it late, although that's still relevant. And in the last talk I gave, we talked about heart failure amelioration and the beneficial effects that can happen in people with established and complex disease. But to detect it very early, and Louise did a beautiful job of covering off some data which we've collected over the years in very young people who nonetheless have high risk factor burdens. So many of you will be familiar with the revolution that happened in vascular physiology around the discovery of nitric oxide and the importance of the endothelium. So I'm not going to labour this slide too much. Suffice to say that if we're looking for an early disease detection surrogate, it might be the function of the vascular endothelium or its dysfunction. So endothelial function plays a key role in multiple myriad atherogenic phenomena: vasodilation, pressure control, shear stress locally, but also luminally, platelet aggregation adhesion, subintimally, monocyte infiltration, transmigration, transformation into foam cells, smooth muscle cell proliferation and transmigration, and also the oxidative status of the subintimal space. Endothelial dysfunction is the earliest detectable atherogenic event that we can pick up in humans. And so there was a push for the last 20 years to develop techniques or approaches where we can detect endothelial dysfunction in vivo. And famously, David Salamire, while working with John Deanfield in London, developed such a technique based on the shear stress stimulation of the endothelium in vivo and using non-invasive vascular ultrasound. And this flow media dilation technique has become extremely common and popular. And we've used it in our lab to determine whether large artery function can be modified, particularly by exercise training. So here's a picture of Andrew Marana and Louise Naylor, who again I acknowledge as being fantastic colleagues. I've been blessed to have such wonderful colleagues throughout my career, and I really acknowledge the great work that these guys have both done. I'm presenting mostly their data here. Andrew's PhD work involves studying type 2 diabetic subjects and coronary disease patients and looking at vascular function in these larger conduit arteries, in this case peripheral arteries like the femoral and brachial artery, and established, this is some of the earliest data in the literature that established that exercise training improves large artery function. This is also replicated in studies by Hambrecht and the German group, who showed that in epicardial coronary arteries, exercise training improves large artery function. Now, today's about skin and microvessels, but the point is that we come to this research about small vessels through this prism of what we've learned in larger arteries. We pose the question in those larger arteries about what the role of shear stress stimulation was. And to examine that, we used a paradigm where we used the fact that people have two arms and that one arm can be manipulated so that the shear stress doesn't increase when you exercise train. So here's an example of a study that we performed some years ago where we did dual hand grip training. The training was the same, identical for both arms. It was obviously done in an individual three times a week over an 8-week period. But in one arm, we put a blood pressure cuff and inflated it to a fairly low pressure, and that just clips the shear stress response so that now you've got a model where exercise is happening on both sides, but the shear stress related to the exercise, or the increase in flow related to the exercise, is high in one arm but not in the other. So it's a model that was set up by us to establish whether shear stress is the driving mechanism that induces large artery change. And I'm going to show you and we also measured peak reactive hyperemia in these patients. Now, this is an idea that goes back a long way, and here's a study from the 1960s, but it goes back further than that. The idea here is that in humans, if you completely vasodilate a blood vessel, you get an idea of its structure. You can't tell much about a blood vessel or an artery structure from its resting tone, because that tone is controlled functionally, and the function may differ. But if you remove all of the functional overlay and you completely dilate the vessel, you've got a measure of its capacity, ergo its structure. So peak reactive hyperemia and peak vessel dilation are surrogates for the remodeling of large arteries. And Louise Naylor, during her PhD, proved this in conduit arteries by using a range of different types of interventions: short-term, long-term ischemia, ischemia with exercise, ischemia with drug infusions, to try and work out which stimulus we can use as a valid surrogate for maximal dilation in conduit arteries. And that resulted in us using a 5-minute period of ischemia with overlaid ischemic exercise. So now I'm going to present a summary of about 4 studies, which are represented in these figures, where we use the cuffing technique to unilaterally modify shear stress. And we did this with hand grip training. We did it with leg exercise training in the upper limbs because the legs cause changes in shear stress systemically. We did it without exercise. We did it just by heating the forearms 3 times a week because that increases shear stress. So now we have a model where there's shear stress but no exercise. And we did this with leg heating as well. So in each of these models, we tried to manipulate the shear stress unilaterally, a change, bilaterally, no such change. So here's the summary of what we found in all of these studies because the results were more or less typical. So on the left-hand panel, you've got the functional response. This is a nitric oxide-mediated endothelium-dependent response, and it increases over the first 4 weeks and then starts to decrease a little bit. In the same person who had the same intervention in the other arm, which didn't get an increase in shear stress during these interventions, there was no adaptation whatsoever. What about our structural index, the peak reactive hyperemia? Well, that takes off at about 4 weeks and increases somewhat, but again, only in the arm that received the shear stress. So the summary of this data, albeit in large arteries, to us was that shear stress is a very important stimulus in humans. It's almost an evolutionary stimulus. You have receptors on endothelial cells that detect shear. When you increase blood flow and shear stress, you get adaptation, and that adaptation improves nitric oxide and endothelial function, and that's anti-atherogenic. So here's a non-risk factor mediated way of improving vascular health in vivo. So we now think that initially, with increases in shear stress, whether they be exercise mediated or otherwise, you get a vascular adaptation in function, which precedes a regulatory increase in artery diameter or remodeling. So there's a functional and a structural thing that happens, and there's a time course that's that relates those two things. Now, that's a long introduction to get to microvessels, but it's relevant because we started to ask the question in our mind whether all of this happens in microvessels. And the reason we ask that is that there's an idea at large that microvascular maladaptation or dysfunction precedes larger artery dysfunction. So if our goal here is really to develop some sort of toolkit which can be used at a bedside to detect whether people's vascular dysfunction is going off well before they get any clinical manifestation, decades before, and then use that to treat the target so we can improve vascular function in those who need it the most, we really need good detection methods of detection for early vascular disease. And FMD is one of them in large arteries, but what if we can get in even earlier because microvascular disease may precede macrovascular disease? That brings us to the skin. And here's my picture of the skin physiology. It's complex. The anatomy is complex. There are sort of parallel array, and there are communicating arteries. So that depending on the depth at which you interrogate the skin, you're actually interrogating very different anatomical structures. But notwithstanding that complexity, the skin may provide an insight, not just into thermoregulation, but into microvascular dysfunction and ultimately larger artery disease, which may be clinically relevant. In diabetes and peripheral artery disease, there's a particular relevance of skin vascular physiology because they manifest symptoms and syndromes in the skin specifically. Atherosclerosis, we know, is a systemic disease. So if you've got it in the skin, it's probably likely to be manifesting somewhere else. And the skin is a very accessible site. You've got a lot of it, it's richly vascular, and it may be a very easy way, if we can develop a non-invasive assay, to have a look at it. So, Louise has already presented this data, which is terrific, because I can shoot through it. This is the study we did with Mark Black, looking at microdialysis techniques, and using, crucially, for my talk, laser Doppler fluxometry. And Louise has shown you the key results, which is that the nitric oxide contribution improves with exercise training. It's impaired in older, unfit people. In older, fit people, it's relatively preserved. So all of that makes for a very nice picture, and we thought we'd done a great job with this study. and we were busy slapping each other on the back, but thought, maybe we don't know everything. Let's do some cuffing experiments to see what happens in the microvessels. So, those macrovessel experiments that I showed you before, where we did conduit artery adaptation with a cuff in one arm, when we did that, we also did microvessel measures using laser Doppler fluxometry. And in this study, published in the Journal of Physiology, we heated the arms using hot water, 42 degrees, 30 minutes. And in one arm, we had a cuff. One arm was uncuffed, which meant that the skin blood flow in that arm increased massively. So did the skin temperature. In the other arm, and there's an image of the change when you heat. In the cuffed arm, though, you get that. So not so much change. We performed this study, and the image on the left here shows the changes in perfusion units of fluxometry in the uncuffed arm and the cuffed arm. In this experiment, we replicated the first one, but we redid it in a way where the forearm heat wasn't a factor. So we clamped the skin temperature, by this time immersing the arms in room temperature water and maintaining that temperature while the core was heated using immersion in a water bath at 42 degrees. So this time a slightly different approach, and we found something very interesting. Instead of seeing an increase in the local skin temperature responses, we saw a decrease after the intervention. Now that's confusing, because up to this point, we're all very comfortable with the idea that if you do repeated stimulation of large arteries or maybe even of microvessels, you should see increases in function and or structure. This showed a drop systematically. So I got very confused. We then did another experiment where instead of heating the lower limbs, we exercise trained people using cycling. We measured the upper limbs. And in this experiment, we saw with our local heating adaptation, the same thing. Instead of increasing after training, we saw a decrease in the skin responses to heat. So that's a bit of a conundrum. It was confusing. And it made me start to think a bit more and a bit more deeply about what it was we were trying to measure and how we were measuring it. And this is where the story comes in about new technology and new techniques and approaches, because what I realized is that we're all dependent very much on laser Doppler fluxometry. And what is that? Well, it's complex, but it's movement of red cells underneath the surface of the skin. Now, the image I showed you earlier shows the skin has parallel array of plexuses, plexi, and it has vertical communicating vessels. And the depth at which fluxometry occurs is not very well understood, and we're not sure what direction the red cells are moving in, whether they're that way, or even that way. And we know nothing about the size of the vessels that we're measuring because we're not imaging them. We don't see the blood vessels, the microvessels. So the flux outcomes that we see are like the red and the blue line to the right. They're a line on a chart recorder. And we all just, I guess, put our faith in those as a valid measure of something that's happening in the skin. Most people who do this sort of stuff are careful not to call it flow, skin flow. Rather call it skin flux, because flow is specific to knowing the diameter of a vessel and knowing the velocity through it. You need those two things to actually calculate flow, and you need the direction that these cells are flowing in. We know none of these things from flux or laser Doppler flowmetry. Now, the second thing that occurred to me was that, okay, the technique we've got is limiting our ability to make really definitive implications about what's happening, but this decrease in heat-related responses that we're seeing after adaptations that we thought would increase flow or flux, I started to think about that at another level, and it took me to muscle physiology and studies on changes that you see with exercise training in microvessels in muscle. And in the studies that I've listed here, which are from the group in Copenhagen, what they've shown is that when you exercise skeletal muscle, you get an increase in capillarisation, or capillarity, if you're American. And that increase in capillarisation actually prolongs transit time. So it takes longer for a red cell to transit after training than it does before training. Now, it's not just teleological. That's important because exercise training increases your capacity to extract oxygen and transfer gases. So this is an adaptation which is advantageous in the muscle. But what do we know about the skin? The skin's role is not really to transfer oxygen and CO2, but transit time might be important because transit time dictates temperature transfer. So a prolongation of transit time would express itself in laser Doppler flux terms as a slowing of flux, not an increase. So I got it into my head that maybe that's what's happening in the skin. Maybe when you stimulate the skin repeatedly, either with exercise training or maybe repeated heating, that something's happening in the skin which is causing an increase in the density of vessels, and that that might decrease the transit time, slow the flux, but it might actually explain the possibility of improved temperature control or temperature transfer. I couldn't prove that with laser Doppler fluxometry, so I started looking around about 3 or 4 years ago for alternative approaches to skin physiology assessment. And I was lucky because in my institution there was a guy called Rob McLaughlin, now works at the University of Adelaide, and this guy is a particularly gifted optics engineer. Rob was developing optical coherence tomography solutions, mostly for cardiologists who wanted to put OCT down a needle and have a look inside coronary arteries at the nature of the plaque. Optical coherence tomography is an incredibly powerful technique. It uses light waves rather than what you'll be familiar with from ultrasound, which are sound waves. But it has some similarities. It has also similarities with MRI because it's very high speed and it takes a series of cuts in a region of interest. You can see those sort of layered up here, and you can see the images of the skin layered as if they were a stack of MRIs. But it does it very quickly, so it can repeat that really quickly. So there's a methodology here where you basically get scatter of the light, and changes in the scatter of the light tell you something about what's moving and where it's moving. But you can also resolve very small structural vessels, down to about 10 microns. A red cell is 7 microns. So this is small. With Rob, we spent a couple of years developing techniques using an OCT machine which we hacked into and modified. OCT is typically used clinically in ophthalmology. When you go to see your optometrist these days, there's usually an OCT measure and it tells us something about retinal vessel changes. So it's been used to do vascular work before, but it's been specific to ophthalmology and optometry. I wondered whether we could use it in the skin and whether it would be modifiable. It uses light waves, there's no radiation, there's no penetration, there's no downside. We can measure vessel diameters at about 10 microns. We can measure movement of cells within those vessels at a resolution of 10 microns. So in this, actually I've put this front image up because you can see sweat glands radiating upwards to the skin surface there. So that gives you an idea of the resolution that we're capable of achieving with this technique. So with Rob, we've developed a technique to the point now where it's routinely used in our lab, and we get images that look a bit like this. So this is an OCT image about 10 by 10 millimetres in size from a camera that's more or less placed on the skin surface. We've developed some special fixtures that we use for this, and inside those fixtures we can put heater discs, the standard heater discs that you might be familiar with. That means we can heat the skin locally and see what happens, and in these images you can see the skin at rest, the skin during heating, and then the skin when we inflate a cuff to congest the veins or the venules. So I think this technique is going to be, I know now that this technique is going to be able to tell us something about vascularity, if you want vessel density, microvessel density. We can hone in on these vessels and measure their diameter and the change in the diameter with things like heating, and we can measure velocity and absolutely calculate flow. And the proof of that methodology was published in the Journal of Applied Physiology a couple of years ago. This is a paper from MSSE, which is in press now, and it shows co-localization of laser Doppler fluxometry and OCT, where we've compared the effects at room temperature and at 44 degrees of local heating, and the images are on your left, and we've done a reproducibility analysis on this, day-to-day replication, and actually we think the OCT is more reproducible notwithstanding the fact that you can actually see the vessels and calculate the flow, it's also more reproducible than laser Doppler flux for a local heating response. We've now done the same study with a reactive hyperemia stimulus using a cuff inflated for 5 minutes and released, and again with laser Doppler and OCT. And here are the diameters at baseline, the velocity through the vessels, the density of the vascularity at baseline and during reactive hyperemia. We're getting reasonably good reproducibility for this technique. There's one other thing I wanted to put up just because, well, I like this idea. This is a study based on the proofs of the circulation by William Harvey. So here's my Harvey inset. What we thought is that, well, Harvey proved that blood flows around the circulation in a time before it was possible to see capillaries. The light microscopes were invented about 50 years after his death. So he was very clever. He used a cuff inflated on the upper limb to a light intensity, so maybe let's say 60 millimetres of mercury, and of course the veins get congested and you can squeeze the blood out of the veins and prove that that blood flows up towards the centre in veins, as against the prevailing notion, which was that it flowed away and outwards from the centre. So he proved that blood flows from arteries to veins. We replicated Harvey's experiment. It's 500 years since that experiment was performed, while we were imaging the microvessels. I think this is the first time this has been done in humans, and it's just nifty. So here are some images that we collected at baseline. The next image I'll show you is with a cuff on the forearm, and we inflated the cuff just to 30 millimetres of mercury. So I think you can see there's a lightening up of the OCT image here. What we then did is deflated the cuff and it went away again. We then did the same experiment. This time we heated using a heater disc to try and increase the flow at baseline. Then we inflated a cuff again to 30 millimetres of mercury, congesting the venules, and deflated the cuff again. And I hope you'll be able to see in this light some difference between those images. When we calculate outputs from that, when the cuff goes up at baseline and when the cuff is released, CR, you see characteristic changes in vascularity in terms of the diameter of target vessels, the density of the vascularity, and other variables. So there's a lot of work to do with this. It's new. We've developed it now to the point where we think it's technically ready. We've had a look at some untrained and trained people. We're in the middle at the moment of going back to the training studies that we performed to try and work out whether those drops in that laser Doppler flux are actually related to increased vessel density or capillarization, if you like. But we're getting somewhere with it. We're also looking at clinical populations. This is a patient with a diabetic foot ulcer. And there's panels to the left with matched controls, non-diabetic patients. In the heating response that you see a generalised and fairly systematic increase with heating in a normal healthy vessel or vessel bed. This is skin on the dorsum of the foot. But in patients with diabetic foot ulcers, you see large vessels which are dilated at rest. For those of you who work in this field, you'll know that diabetics have hot feet, but they also have microangiopathy. When you heat diabetic feet, you don't see the systematic increase, at least routine, at least generalised across that circulatory patch. You see dilation in those large vessels, which we think are bypass vessels. You're getting high flows, but without any tissue nutrition. So we think this could be useful in diabetics. We think it's probably useful in peripheral artery disease patients, but we think hopefully it's generically useful as an early detection methodology. So this is my slide based on the drive to my hometown in Western Australia. Is the future going to be the same as the past? I think there's some technical development we still need to do. It's technically possible to render 3D images using OCT. So at the moment I've showed you flat 2D images. That's because we've flattened all of the vessels that we're detecting into sort of one layer. The strength of this technique is going to be actually lifting that all out in a concertina fashion and having a look at the 3D anatomy. We should then be able to measure velocity in 3D, and that means flow. At the moment the technology is such that we're getting static images. You can sort of get two images in about a 30-second period, but that's as quick as it gets. I think as the technology improves, we'll get dynamic imaging, and that should be a goal because physiology is dynamic. I think the next step, we're going to combine this with the microdialysis approach that Louise and Helen have shown us and see what we can actually see happening next to our dialysis membrane, and that'll be fascinating. And we need to develop robust 3D imaging phantoms to make sure that what we're saying is really, truly valid. From a physiological viewpoint, I think the ultimate goal here would be a bedside option for early disease detection, microvascular disease. But I think it'll also be useful ultimately to determine whether drug therapies, which are supposed to be about improving vascular function, are actually working in everyone, and maybe developing a treat-to-target strategy around that. I think there's a lot of work to do around exercise training and heating studies, and of course, there's a lot of work to be done around patient groups who we know have microvascular disease already. So, one last slide, and this is by virtue of Howard Carter, who was a PhD student with me and then spent two very successful years with Ylva Helston, the University of Copenhagen. Howard really drove a lot of this work, and I have to give him great credit for the OCT development. He's technically a very gifted guy. But with Ylva, he went a slightly different direction and started doing confocal microscopy on skin biopsies, and you can see some very nice images here of endothelial cells lighting up with papillary loops very clear, ascending and descending vessels, and cutaneous plexi visible. I think if we can combine this sort of approach with the real-time OCT work, we're going to be in a very powerful place. So, this is my hometown of Perth, Western Australia. I put this up because we're advertising for PhD students and postdocs, and you're all very welcome to come and talk to me or Louise at the end of the meeting if any of this has interested you at any level. Thank you for listening.
So thanks very much, Danny, for a fantastic talk. Any questions, please? We've gone slightly over time, but we've got time for a couple of questions. Danny, with the new technology you've got there, does it solve the complexity issue in the dermis in terms of the layering of the plexi and the orientation of the vessels?
Yeah, that's the $64 question. So I think we'll be able to unpick the flattening thing that we're doing so that we'll get 3D imaging. Technically that's doable now. And it's going to involve a lot of processing, some engineering work. But the goal is to have 3D imaging and then with the dynamic imaging that I think will be possible as the machinery improves, we might even see blood flowing in real time in three dimensions, which would be terrific.
Yeah. Thanks a lot. Thanks a lot for your presentation. Also, the previous talks, very great session. Lukas Strasen, my name, from University of Basel. I was wondering, or I would like to have some discussion about the endothelial function and the measurement of endothelial function. You also had some great techniques to measure the dilatation response, and you said this is endothelial function, but what would you say if I say that's only 50% of our endothelial function? What do you say about the constriction? I think the constriction of the, especially the microcirculation, even if we talk about high blood pressure, for example, the Bayley's effect, yeah, is also a very important function of our microcirculation. It would be great to have the statement of that.
Do you want to take that? Would you get the other one up?
They don't want to come up, Danny. They're saying they're out of time. But you answer that question.
Yeah. So I hope that in my talk I gave you the impression that I'm a pretty simple guy. I started out with big fat tubes and trying to understand what they did, right? And those conduit arteries are not that complicated. There's sort of a set of brakes, and you can either push the brakes a bit or you can take your foot off. But that's about it. The skin is way more complicated. And, you know, I'm not a skin vascular physiologist, and I'm happy to admit to that, because there's lots of people in this audience and elsewhere who've spent their lives trying to understand how the skin works, and it's pretty complicated, mainly because there's two nervous systems, you know, and there's transmitters we don't even know about. and it has the ability to constrict and dilate, and it's got an accelerator pedal and a brake pedal, and you know, it's exquisitely controlled. The fundamental point, though, is that we're never going to understand it fully unless we can see it. And I'm a great believer in the Enlightenment idea that you don't really believe anything until you can see it. And so I'm also a big imaging fan for that reason. And you know, my history in this field has been starting out with strain gauge plethysmography, which gives you a line on a screen. And you've got to sort of do all the mental interpretation about what it means and what it's saying. And then ultrasound came along and I could see the artery and I could see it moving and changing, and I thought that was amazing. And so now I've done a lot of ultrasound research. And when I came to this problem with laser Doppler flowmetry, it's just struck me as another example like that, where we have to do better and find a way to image it. And that's the starting point for understanding what the constrictors are doing, what the dilators are doing. If we can combine this technique with microdialysis, we're going to be in a pretty healthy place to understand the physiology for the first time.
Okay, thanks, Danny. I'm guessing by the entry of the crowd, we better make a move. So could I ask the audience to thank Louise, Helen and Danny once again. Thank you for a great session.
Good. Yeah. Fun. That's fun.